What's the mosquito sushi can say?
We're Fox 14 ABC in kind of Macon, Georgia.
Yeah,
I'm a journalism major.
Oh, really?
That's why I wouldn't talk to anybody.
Gentlemen, welcome to Kennesaw State University this evening, and I want to welcome our students, our faculty, and staff on this very first day of class, as well as, if you want to applaud for the first day of class, please do. I also want to thank the other members of our greater community that have come tonight for this town hall. We're honored to host Senator Johnny Isakson at the Daily Performing Arts Center. I want to thank, we have numerous of our veterans here, and we thank you gentlemen and ladies, and we greatly appreciate all you come for. I also want to thank Commissioner Mike Roby of the Georgia Department of Veterans Services and several of the senior staff who are with us tonight. So thank you, Commissioner. We will begin tonight's program with the Pledge of Allegiance led by Girl Scout Troops 13450 and 14396. Scouts, please lead us in the pledge. If y'all would please stand. Thank you. I want to remind you that no signs were to be brought into the auditorium today. If any audience members brought in a sign, you're welcome to take it to the foyer and to pick up the sign at the end of tonight's program. If that means you've assigned, please take it to the foyer. The idea is that you don't obstruct other individuals' views of the stage, so we need to be courteous. Johnny Isakson, ladies and gentlemen. Johnny Isakson is a successful businessman and respected public servant, but he's most proud of his family, his wife Diane, his three children, and his eight grandchildren. Senator Isakson is the only Georgian ever to have been elected to our state house, our state senate, the U.S. House, and the U.S. Senate, not to mention serving as chair of the State Board of Education. Johnny is the only senator who chairs two committees, the Senate Ethics Committee and the Senate Veterans Affairs Committee. We are here to have a civil discussion, may we?
Yes.
Working closely with Ranking Member John Tester, major legislation has passed this year to improve health care benefits and support provided by the Veterans Administration to our veterans. This month, Senator Isakson introduced bipartisan legislation to help stop the scourge of online sex trafficking and to help victims of this horrendous crime. Kennesaw State University is honored to host the program for the university and the community. Ladies and gentlemen, let's give a warm welcome to Senator Johnny Isakson.
Thank you very much, Sam Owens. I want to thank Kennesaw State University, Cobb County Police Department, Sheriff's Department, the officers in the Kennesaw State Security Office, Sheriff's Department, Sheriff Neil Warren's here, Sheriff Keith Warren and I go back as old friends years ago, all the other elected officials and officials in Kennesaw State. Thank you so much on this busy first day of school for taking the time to host us and let us have this town hall meeting. I also want to recognize and let you know that in this room is a very seasoned politician. Her name is Victoria Brock. She's pleasant and student governor at Kennesaw State, and she ran 2 years in a row and won both years. I wanted to meet her. Okay, and I understood why I never would, and she would. Thank the Girl Scouts, and thank you for around. I think somebody said they're having trouble.
Got a couple hundred people outside, so this is good.
Is that better?
Thank you. Anytime you need to correct me, just let me know. Well, thank the members of the media that are here today. Thank all of you for coming. Now, I've only got one rule in my town hall meetings. They're all about you, they're not about me. But to make sure everybody gets to ask a question that possibly wants to, nobody can ask a second question until everybody has had their first question answered. That way, we make sure we get the maximum number of questions asked and don't intentionally keep anybody from getting a question answered. I am going to respond to one issue, though, because you deserve to hear it. I don't want to take a lot of time. It's a dominant issue. Some of you ought to know what I've said and how I feel about it. There's no place in the greatest country on the face of this earth for what happened in Charlottesville, Virginia last weekend. There is no place for the Ku Klux Klan, white supremacy, or racism. We can have
We can have differences over lots of things, but there's never going to be a difference over human dignity, the rights of life, and the right to live in the freest, greatest country on the face of this earth without fear of intimidation because of your race, your religion, your sex, your national origin, or any other discriminatory factor. We are America. Here's how we're going to operate tonight. I have five people with microphones in the audience. I'm going to recognize folks to ask a question. When I recognize you, I'm going to have to point to you because I don't know who you are. Nobody from my operation can ask a question. They're on my payroll. I don't want you to think I got anybody here that's a plant. But I'll recognize you, and we'll get as many questions answered as you allow us to get answered, and as I can come up with short, concise, and to the point answers.
And many other people.
There is one person, though. Kevin, where are you?
Just in the past couple of minutes.
I'm going to let the first question come from right over here to my left and your right. Would you ask the lady to please give her name and where she's from and pose the question
throughout the night, and of course also.
Thank you, Senator Isakson. My name is Dawn Alford, and I am originally from Temple, Georgia, and I work as an advocate for people with developmental disabilities, and that's the nature of my question. In your July telephone town hall, you committed to never, quote, knowingly vote to cut a developmental disability benefit, but later in the month, you voted for all four of the Senate health care bills, which would have cut and restructured Medicaid to the tune of over $770 billion, according to the Congressional Budget Office, which would have hurt thousands of Georgians with disabilities just like me and across the state. I live in fear over this, Senator Isakson. I've been losing sleep over it. And so my question to you is this: can you please explain, after you made that commitment, why did you vote yes on those bills that would have cut Medicaid? And how can you reassure me and all the other Georgians with disabilities like me who rely on Medicaid that you will now, going forward, commit not to vote for any such bill that would cut Medicaid?
Great question. From the obvious response, it not only obviously we'll get an answer, but it'll be an extended answer, which hopefully will answer a lot of other questions that are going to come forward. To get to the point in the process that we're on in terms of the health care bill, to get to the point to make the impact you want to make, you've got to get it to a conference committee or it isn't going to happen. That's the way the process is. Well, if you would be quiet, I would answer the question, but I'm trying to be respectful. To get to the conference committee, you reduce the number of people who are in play from 535 to about 35 members of the House and Senate. All people with a vested interest and a responsibility in health care like I have in the Health, Education, Labor, and Pension Committee. I served on the committee that oversaw the entire debate of the Affordable Care Act under President Obama. I'm on the same committee today. In the final presentation that was made to the bill I didn't like but voted for, because I wanted, hold on. I couldn't get to where I wanted to go unless I followed the road that led me there. If I was going to downtown Atlanta but didn't want to get on 75 and probably couldn't get there otherwise, then I'd never get there. But if getting on 75 and fighting the traffic would eventually get where I wanted to go, that's what I want to do, and where you are is where I wanted to go. So. So as I said before, if we get to 2 points of difference between the House and the Senate, you have a conference committee appointed to reconcile those points.
That is the chance I had to be a major player in the ultimate decision, because I probably would. I can't guarantee what position I would have been in, but because of seniority in the committees I'm on, I would have been in the final play for the conference committee had I been there, and I kept my promise, and I'd have kept my promise on the votes I had on the floor. But the answer to your question, which she has heard twice and will hear it for a third time, you couldn't get to that point without moving forward the bill that would get it into a conference committee.
You could have said no.
Thank you.
Yeah. Say no.
No.
I just explained the answer to why I said yes, to get to the point to make the difference, and I'll continue to again. Let me say one other thing. I have some respect for your concerns. I've most recently become a disabled person myself. This is my cane. I know how lucky. I know how lucky I've been all my life. I know how fortunate I am to live in America. I want to see till we get to the country that doesn't cut anything for disabilities. We haven't yet. As far as I'm concerned, we're not going to. But we got to get there by the way that'll take us there, not by some promise you can never keep. Yes, ma'am. Hold on one second, please. If we're all playing by the rules, everybody gets their chance. If we don't, nobody is. This lady right here, could you please stand? Where's my mic up front? While he's coming over there, this lady right here with the glasses, would you stand up? You'll be right after this person. Well, there are two of them with glasses. You're going to have to fight it out. Yes, ma'am.
Thank you for holding this town hall and being willing to hear from constituents. I appreciate that.
It's
Trump's
job.
Trump's dangerous rhetoric is fanning the flames with North Korea. His words could provoke the unstable Kim Jong-un and further escalate tensions when our top priority should be de-escalation and diplomacy. Will you denounce Trump's dangerous rhetoric that puts our national security at risk? And will you demand that Trump comes to Congress first before engaging in any sort of military operation against North Korea?
The President of the United States, under the Constitution of the United States and the laws of this country, has up to 60 days to deploy troops at his discretion or her discretion in response to a threat to the country. So that I cannot usurp. After that, the War Powers Act takes over. Congress is integrally involved in what can happen. And just as has happened with Afghanistan and Iraq and Kosovo before it, the Congress has to authorize it, or it doesn't happen at all. So the answer to your question is yes, I support the Congress having to say so. They do have to say so, but the President does, under the law of the land and the Constitution, have the ability in the first 60 days to deploy the American troops.
Amend the Constitution.
And that wasn't the question, but I'm just trying to answer the question. Yeah.
Thank you, Senator Isakson, for holding this town hall meeting. My name is Melissa Connor. I'm from Decatur, Georgia. My husband and I own two small businesses and have been self-employed for over 25 years. I'm a cancer survivor, and my husband has diabetes. And getting and keeping health insurance as a small business owner has been one of our biggest challenges. Last year, we paid $20,000 for health insurance. But prior to that, without the ACA, we did without. Since the ACA, we've been finally safely insured, and while premiums have increased, we have at least coverage, and I can count on that. Now's the time to approve it. There are at least 20 plus changes that policy experts have suggested that could change the ACA for the better, but I'd like to concentrate on four. Expanding Medicaid. Seven hospitals have closed up. Two of them in Atlanta are in financial trouble. 56% of the babies born at CHOA are on Medicaid. States that have expanded Medicaid are already well ahead of us. Maternal health care is disappearing in rural Georgia. One OBGYN doctor serves eight counties and 2,714 square miles in Thomaston, Georgia. One. Half of the Georgia counties, 79, do not have an obstetric provider. Take the federal money and get us out of this death spiral. an insurance company want to come to Georgia with the population in such poor health? They won't. They are money-making machines. The 9 CEOs from the health insurance industry made a whopping $283 million annually last year. They are beholden to their shareholders, not the poor and the unhealthy in Georgia. They need incentive, and the risk corridors will do that. Help them do the groundwork and negotiate with our providers and hospitals. Senator Rubio was wrong. Doing away with the risk corridors destroyed the true competition in our insurance marketplace. Number three, commit to the CSRs. With money on the table, the insurance companies don't like to guess what their commitment will be from the federal government. Yes. And stabilize the marketplace. Every threat we make to them just puts your constituents at risk. Number four, doctors, nurses, pharmacists, they need to be in charge of our health care, not paper pushing actuaries. Medical providers should be at the top of the list. Raise the compensation for Medicaid and Medicare coverage for their pay. Pay them better for these patients. It's a shame that we've allowed insurance companies to hijack our medical industry. End surprise insurance gaps in the emergency rooms. You cannot make a decision about your health care provider when you are in a major trauma accident. And also, the Blue Cross Blue Shield ER policy, where you have to go to an urgent care before you can go to an ER. I mean, that's just saving them money. That is not what's good for us. And I participated in your town hall recently, and you said something that concerned me. You said one of the solutions was to sell insurance across state lines. Senator, I beg to differ. We've offered that legislation since 2011. It's been on the books in Georgia, and not one single insurance company has taken us up on it. Thank you very much.
Great job, thank you. And thank you for well thought out five questions. You got around the rule pretty easy, but you deserve it.
I appreciate you. You can help us.
And I will help you. And I'm going to tell you a couple things we're doing to help you right now. One of the least published things by some of these ladies and gentlemen over here in the press pool is the fact that I'm the fourth signer on the Collins-Cassidy health care bill, which was introduced shortly before Mitch McConnell introduced his bill. I have been on the side of a lot of things you're talking about already in this debate. Didn't win out, but we stayed in for the better end. You're correct on a number of those points. I'm going to add a couple of points. I ran a business for a long time. I had independent contractors work for me. There are a lot of independent contractors in this room. You can't, as an independent contractor, your employer can't do group medical insurance for you because they're not allowed during the IRS test. So we allowed association health plans to be created, where if you were a carpenter or a realtor or an electrician, you were a flight attendant, whatever it might be, you could assemble yourself with others in the same profession, create a risk group that would absorb the losses easier and have a much lower premium. That was legal for years, but was slowly but surely was ruled out of it. We need to put it back in place. It's the best alternative to get around the insurance companies and force them to come to you to compete for your business rather than say we're the only act you've got in town. You have great points. You have the points that justify the reason my answer to the other question was to get from point A to point B. You had to make the votes I made to get to the conference committee. That's where in the end you're going to get the chance to have ideas like that, that in the environment we were set in this last quarter were not possible. I appreciate your question and your thoughtfulness. You're right. And I appreciate the opportunity to come here. Okay, I'm not going to, now, after this, I'm going to recognize other people and we're going to get stuck from yelling
back.
Part
of your question, though. What about
Medicaid?
I've been in elected office in Georgia since 1976. Most of those were in the Georgia legislature. The state legislature, as you all know, manages the Medicaid program. The federal state matches 65-35. It's a federal program with a heavy state involvement. I've been involved in Medicaid for a long time. Medicaid has been the primary insurance coverage or health care coverage for many Georgians and will be even more in the future. There are more and more people coming up eligible because they have no more alternatives, as well as the dual eligibles like those that are losing kidneys and on dialysis. I will never want to cut those individuals, but want to instead expand the opportunity where other matches come in. I'm a big supporter of a lot of the healthcare bills that some don't like as much because the government doesn't control them as much. They leave the insurance company and the customer to negotiate. Medicare Advantage being a good example, negotiate the benefit that they want. Whatever we can do, excuse me, for you to get the benefit that you want and to make it available to more Georgians, I'm going to work to do any time. There's a gentleman right back here with his hand up. You stand up. Is that a gentleman or a lady? All right, gentlemen, they get it right. I didn't want to misidentify anybody. Who's got a mic? Tommy? There you go. Right behind you.
Thank you very much for your service to our country and to the state of Georgia. My name is Brad Cook. I'm a father of two 11-year-old girls. I live in Atlanta. And it's an honor and privilege to be able to speak to you today. I was wondering if you could help me understand your position on what's called anthropogenic global warming. That is global warming caused by the activities of human beings. Do you believe that it is occurring? And if so, why? And if not, why not? And secondly, if you do believe that anthropogenic global warming is occurring, what should the United States government do about it?
I know what I don't know, and I don't know what anthropogenic means. You can tell me what that is.
That's a shame!
If you just let him do it, I can hear one person here to say it.
I'm sorry, excuse me. It's caused by human activity. Global warming.
I went in the interview with Dr. Alley at Penn State, the glaciologist, the leading glaciologist in North America.
I don't have the privilege of knowing.
I had the privilege, when this issue became a huge issue as I was elected to the Senate in 2004, I went to Disco Bay in Greenland, which is where the glaciers are melting, with Dr. Alley and other leading glaciologists to try and see for myself many things that were being claimed, particularly with regard to carbon. As a contributor to the deterioration of the ice cap. I am a full believer that carbon contributes to the atmospheric problems that contribute to the rise in temperatures. It's a contributor. I think the climate change, if you watch the weather every night, you know the climate's always changing, and it's not always changing.
Go back to school. So.
Okay, I scratched the weather. I won't talk about weather anymore. But the answer to the gentleman's question, with the exception of not knowing the definition of the word he used, I do know that carbon is a contributor, and it's a man-made byproduct, many things that we do. Everything we can do to reduce carbon is a benefit for health, as well as other things. I was a big supporter of the Montreal protocols on fluorocarbons that brought down the closing of the ozone hole, and that was done voluntarily. I think we ought to have positive goals to have positive results, and we ought to have industry and the people who are a part of it contributing together to make it happen. I will always be a big believer in that. I think that's the right way to go. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you.
Good evening, Senator Al Lippert, Stone Mountain, Georgia. Veterans of Foreign Wars Department of Georgia, and a member of the National Legislative Committee for our national organization. Senator, the VFW has long worked with you and your staff on the important issues affecting veterans and their families. The VFW would like to first thank you for your bipartisan leadership on recent victories to include expanding the GI Bill, modernizing VA's appeals process, authorizing 28 VA medical leases, including one in Pike County, and ensuring continued funding for the Choice Act. We hope you can continue the momentum to finally expand the VA caregiver program to veterans who served before September the 11th, 2001. What is the plan to finally accomplish this in this current Congress? Thank you, sir.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you for your service to the country, and to all of you from the veterans organizations, please stand up. And everybody who's a veteran, please stand up. That great country we all love so much wouldn't be the country it is today without these men and women, and we appreciate you very much. It was my honor to serve too as well, and I appreciate it. The answer on caregivers, right now caregivers' benefits to veterans' families end post-Vietnam. Vietnam conflict of the veterans now are in the most need of assistance. I'm in the most need of assistance too, and I apologize for my call. Can't do anything about it. I have committed next year, along with Patty Murray, a Democrat from Washington State, to introduce legislation that will take caregivers through the Vietnam era, so all veterans will now be eligible to those benefits, not just veterans from certain era conflicts, but not others. Nobody deserves it more than those families. And caregivers are those husbands and wives and loved ones who provide the assistance and the service to those soldiers desperately injured fighting on behalf of our country. It's a way to give them the benefits and the help and the support to keep those people's quality of life high, and to a maximum extent, minimize the hospitalization and institutionalization of people, and maximize people's ability to live at home with their families. And I commit to you, I will be a co-sponsor to what's introduced next year, and I'll work as hard as I can to get it done. Since you asked that question, there's one other Vietnam-era question that's out there, and that's the Blue Water Navy. There has been a claim for some time, that those soldiers and sailors served on ships that carried napalm deserve the paid safe benefit of others affected by napalm in our military. The scientific evidence on napalm is not as conclusive in terms of aircraft and that exposure as the benefits that are currently available. But death is a pretty conclusive thing for me. They risk their life for me and for you. I think the evidence is clear enough that we ought to include the Blue Water Navy benefits on that exposure, so those people have the opportunity to survive the terrible diseases that are byproducts of napalm and its exposure. And I'm going to work on that as well. I've got a guy with a yellow tie right over your shoulder, sir, there's somebody behind you. I'm going to get you both next. You first, with the flag. No, sir, you.
Hang on.
That's okay. First, I wanted to thank you for your service to this country. Secondly, Senators Perdue and Cotton have recently introduced a bill in the Senate called the RAISE Act to change the Immigration Act as it exists now for more skilled workers and less family and making it less family oriented and requiring people to speak English. To that, I have two questions. When your forefathers came here, did they speak English? And my second question. My second question, respectfully, is what is your position? Thank you very much.
Okay. The answer to the first question is Anders Isakson, who was Anders Bengtsson's son, who came to the States and changed his last name to Isakson because he was the son of Isaac. Those of you who are Scandinavian know that's the way they do it. He couldn't speak a word of English. He was a contractor when he came to America. On Fridays at payday, he couldn't speak English either. You know, that was a joke, by the way. But I agree with you. We are very fortunate that America opened to its tired, its poor, its hungry, yearning to be free. I pray for legal immigration. We pray for illegal immigration. We should enforce our immigration laws and make sure those getting in are legal. The only other caveat I'll put in there is this. The numbers that are approved on an annual basis should be calibrated to unemployment. If we have low unemployment in America, there's nothing wrong with bringing workers in to meet the demands of America. If we have high unemployment, then we shouldn't be bringing the workers to take those jobs. We should have Americans going back to work. So your immigration has always been calibrated that way and always will be. Gentlemen, the yellow tie. Great question.
Thank you. I'm sorry. Is that no to the RAISE Act?
The RAISE Act lowers the amount of immigration coming into the country. It does enforce the legal side of immigration coming into the country. Right. My belief is that the numbers should be dictated in large measure by the amount of unemployment in the United States of America, not by an arbitrary act.
We're at the lowest unemployment rate in 16 years, so they shouldn't be coming.
I'm not talking about one moment in time, I'm talking about as a matter of practice. So we got the lowest we ever had, we ought to have high immigration coming into the country. Yeah. The way. Gentlemen, yellow tie. Still with the yellow tie.
Senator, my name is Justin. I'm from Rome, Georgia. I'm a student here at KSU, and I'm also a veteran. And before I ask anything, I just want to thank you on behalf of other student veterans for everything you have done and continue to do for support for us. But today, my question for you is on the ever-growing national debt. After multiple attempts by Congress to create a true balanced budget and other attempts to pass a balanced budget amendment, a movement from the 1970s has been rekindled. This movement, spearheaded by the leading group for an Article 5 amendment, the Balanced Budget Amendment Task Force, is to propose a balanced budget amendment by an Article 5 convention of states. Currently, the total number of states that have passed the required resolutions is 27. Only 7 states are required to call this convention for proposing an amendment. And with this, the realistic anticipation of reaching 34 states within the next election cycle, Arizona's legislature has called for the first ever Article 5 Planning Convention to be held this September. My question to you is this, sir. What is your stance on the current national Article 5 movement and the constitutional amendment for a balanced budget being done by an Article 5 Convention of States?
I support and have supported the 2 times in 19 years I've had the chance to vote for a constitutional amendment on a balanced budget. I have supported it. Any other mechanism to get to that point, I support as well, as long as it's legitimate and within the system, and certainly the Constitutional Convention is within that capability. Until we start to manage our obligations, we're going to find ourselves pretty much attracted to our own debt. We're not going to be the country that we used to be. See, let me go to the back. I've been up front a lot. We have a hand back here. Yes, way back in the back. I can't. I don't think you recognize the person, but y'all see her back there? I'm not pointing at you, Vance.
So first off, I'm a man. You're thrilled with you, I know.
I apologize.
It's okay. So before I get to my question, I want to tell you where I'm from. My name is Jason. I currently live in Peachtree Corners.
Woo!
Thanks. I have a computer science degree from Georgia Tech. I taught computer science for 2.5 years. I worked at a top 100 website. I worked in Silicon Valley. And the reason I say this is so that you know exactly where I'm coming from. And this is about net neutrality, which is... so I want to define the word before I ask. Net neutrality is the idea that your internet service provider cannot censor what you see online.
Amen.
So if I have Comcast and they provide their own news service, they cannot reject news from, say, CNN. So do you support net neutrality? If so, why? If not, why not?
Thank you. Okay.
I think because the internet is a phenomenal invention that's given great access to things that people never had before. If you don't have support for it, it'll be taken away and taxed away, and you won't have it there, so I'm for it 100%. You're waving your hand. If you stand up, thank you very much. Would y'all please give this lady a mic real quick? There's a gentleman here in blue and orange white shirt right here in front of me. He's had his hand up for a long time. And I'm going to trust that my judgment is good and I'm going to recognize him next.
Good evening. My name is Patty Garrett, and I am a member of an organization called Mothers of Black Boys United and Mothers of Black Boys United for Social Change. And thank you. Our mission, so first of all, there's sister organizations dedicated to positively influencing how black boys and men are perceived and treated by law enforcement and in society. So Mom United for Social Change is our voice. A few things that we're focused on is influencing policy at the federal, state, and local levels to ensure that black boys and men are treated fairly and equitably, eradicating harassment, brutality, and unwarranted use of deadly force by law enforcement, and ensuring our sons and the law enforcement officers make it home safely every night. So my question is more so, what do you support the law enforcement taking courses on de-escalating issues? Because, I mean, I know you see what's going on in the world. I have a black son, obviously, because I'm a mother in this organization. I want to see my son, who's 23 years old, be able to grow up into a man and continue to live his life safely. And I'm terrified for him.
The biggest problem confronting our country, one of the single biggest problems confronting our country, is the plight of our teenage kids today when they become adults, whether they're yellow, brown, black, white, or another color.
Black lives matter! Black lives matter! All lives matter!
Our children are a message we send to a time you and I will never see. And we're not sending a very good message right now. We've got to do a lot better than that. If we don't, when I chaired the State Board of Education in Georgia for 2 years, people used to always talk about attention deficit disorder as being the big learning disability. I said, it's not the learning disability. Parental deficit disorder is the problem. Parents aren't raising their kids like they should. Organizations like yours and others that work to support children, the more problems and activities and learn more learning in those teenage years, we'll have less kids on the street, more kids working, well educated. That's good for me, that's good for you, and it's good for you. All lives matter. The gentleman with the yellow, the blue and yellow stripes is next. Yes, sir.
Hi. As an openly gay student at KSU, currently there are no federal or state laws that protect some of my liberties. I can be fired from my job for my sexual orientation. I can be kicked out of my home for my sexual orientation. Would you support a comprehensive Civil Rights Act that not only protects my liberties, but all of the liberties of all Americans to pursue work opportunities, no matter what their age, sexual orientation, apparently, especially? Would you support a comprehensive Civil Rights Act that supports that?
You have every right to be treated fairly and equitably, as does every American, regardless of their orientation, their familiarization, their sex, or any other situation. You have that right, and I'll always stand up for that right. When you talk about an amendment to the Constitution, I think you said an amendment to the Constitution, did you not?
Or bill.
Yeah. as long as it applies to all the civil rights of all people, regardless of their orientation or their choice, then I support it completely. But if it begins to single out one over another,
I don't. Support and die.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, you. Just pointing your finger at yourself. Thank you for the question.
Hey, good evening, Senator. First, I'd like to thank you, like everybody else, for holding this town hall. I know a lot of your colleagues don't have the guts to come and talk to us. They're going to speak to us. I want to tell you. I want to tell you about my son, Jake. He was born exactly 3 years ago. Tomorrow is his birthday. And he was born with a heart condition. It wasn't because he made a bad lifestyle choice. It didn't because he decided to invest in money in his iPhone over his healthcare. He was just born that way. And Obamacare helped us basically protect him from premiums going up just because he has a good skin condition. He will never ever be a good business case for an insurance company. When they look at him, they see dollars that they're going to lose, and they don't want to insure him. There's just no money to be made.
It's an individual mandate.
Would you ever support a single payer system that allows every human being to that allows every human being in this country to get the healthcare that they need, not the healthcare they can afford based on the health insurance company. Thank you so much.
The answer to your first part of the question, which is the individual mandate, and this was in Jim Galloway's article the other day, I've been quoted many, many times on this. The way it currently exists in the Affordable Care Act, you should repeal it, but you've got to replace it with an individual mandate that works. Let me give you an example of what I'm talking about. Insurance only works when you can manage your worst liabilities against your best assets. When you only have people who are drawing on the system, participating in the system, the cost goes crazy and you lose. So we need everybody participating because they want to, because they have to. Let me give you a good example. Let's hold on and listen to this. That's a pretty good answer. Even if it's mine. If you look at what we did in this state in the 1980s, we had terrible problems with automobile insurance. People were getting killed. There was no coverage. We passed a mandate that said, you've got to have minimum no fault or you can't get a license tag. So all of a sudden you had everybody contributing and you had a good situation. I'm for anything that for the right reasons, brings everybody participating in the situation to maximize amount of people participating in the system and minimize the amount of people that are lost. A single payer system can be a system that's part of that, but there are other things that you can do as well. I beg your pardon? I couldn't hear this. Anyway, God bless you to your son, and I hope we can get to the point where you don't have that concern anymore. And I think it's going to happen because the pressure that you know, a lot of people say, why are you doing this town hall? You don't need to do it. You're not up for an election. You don't have to do it. You don't have to do it because I represent you. It's your government, not mine. And the way you get to the solutions that you're advocating is not by trying to yell over the next guy, but working with the system to try and make change happen and work.
We are scared.
Honey, I'm a lot of things, but scared ain't one of them. Yes. This lady right here. Yes. I see a hand waving right there. Yes, ma'am. Somebody get the mic to her. While you're doing it, I saw a hand. No, I've been in this corner too much. There's one in the center back here in the front row. Up there next. Yes, ma'am.
I just want to thank you for having this town hall. I've never been to one before, but the atmosphere in my country makes me kind of nervous, and so this is the first one I've been to, so thank you for having it. I just want to say that you and my husband have something in common. You both have Parkinson's disease. We have a great Parkinson's disease support group. and it's in East Cobb, and we'd love to invite you to attend. In fact, the organization that sponsors our support group, the Aloha to Aging, is having their annual fundraiser this Saturday in Marietta, so we'd be glad to have you there. But my questions, I guess I have four. First of all,
make them fast, they're going to get mad at me.
How are you doing with Parkinson's disease? How are you feeling? Secondly, how are you keeping Parkinson's disease from affecting your work as a senator? Number three, now that you have pre-existing condition, do you have a new appreciation of the pre-existing cause of any health care solution that you might put forward? And if so, what would you do about it? Thank you.
Thank you very much. There's a lady in this room whose name is Downtown Toni Brown. She's an attractive blonde lady who does my scheduling. If you will, Tony, if you will find this lady when the meeting's over,
and get
the time and date, I'll try my best to be there, number one. Number two, I'm doing the best I can. You have to be a judge, am I doing all right? I'm trying as hard as I can to manage my life. Yes, you always know more about an issue when you experience it personally than when you do when you read about somebody else. So yes, it's had an impact on me. And lastly, I'm trying to have an impact on others to help those who have Parkinson's seek the kind of help they need to live as good a life as they can, and hopefully participate in enough research to get to a point where Parkinson's is something that's no longer a death sentence or a lifetime, but it's something that you can manage, control, and I work with the National Institute of Health to do that every single day. Thank you very much. Where was that? Right back there, yes.
Again, sir, really we do thank you for hosting this town hall and exhibiting leadership on that issue, because we've asked for town halls repeatedly and now we have one. It is outside of the city center during rush hour, but I appreciate you being here. And I want to get back to this issue of leadership and back to global warming, because I feel like you dodged the question a little bit. You did state that you believe that human activity, that burning carbon, is contributing to global warming. And this comes back to leadership. We are not members of Congress. You are our voice in the Senate. So right now, Scott Pruitt at the EPA is dismantling all kinds of rules that were passed. He's decimating all the protections that over the past 8 years that the administration was able to put in place. Now, we can't do anything about it. You are our voice. If you believe that global warming is happening because of human activity, you have to act for us. We can't. We can't do anything. I'm not yet, because I have a very specific question. So, number one, are you willing to exert some leadership and break ranks with your Republican colleagues? Tell your fellow senators and tell this administration that what Scott Pruitt is doing is ruining the future for our families and our children. The second question, and this is very specific, your Democratic colleagues in the Senate have put forward a bill to ban the use of, I'm going to mangle the pronunciation, but it's chlorpyrifos, which is it's a pesticide that causes brain damage in children. Now, there was a ban put in place under the EPA in 2015. As soon as Scott Pruitt was given charge of the EPA, he rolled back that ban. Your Democratic colleagues have sponsored legislation to ban the use of this chemical. Will you break ranks and support this legislation? And that's a yes or no question.
earlier answer about carbon.
2018.
My earlier answer about carbon was I do believe it's contributing to changes in climate. I believe anything we can do to reduce the amount of carbon we produce is a good idea.
People before party.
You referenced scientists before, and now you don't want to?
I didn't understand that. And I'm willing to help do anything that is right. I'm not willing to be a poster child for somebody that wants me to be a point of a spear for a political battle rather than something else. Somebody else. I didn't mention political parties.
How about that?
And we have one right back here.
Because it's down chemical.
Obviously.
What are you doing about it? How are you helping us save the planet for our grandchildren, sir?
Go ahead with your question.
Well, I was really interested in hearing the answer to the last question. I'm going to do a brief lead-in here and ask kind of one question.
All right.
I'm trained as a scientist. I'm currently a psychiatrist. 2-3% of school-aged children worldwide have ADHD. It horrifies me that you could cavalierly trash science like that while we're standing in the room with you. But that's not a question. I'm articulating it. Here's my question. 75 years ago, a quarter of my family was incinerated in Europe. Will you call for the President of the United States to remove confessed Nazis, not suspected Nazis, not adjudged Nazis, self-admitted white supremacists, namely Steve Bannon?
Question is, I don't stand in anywhere for any individual that's an anti-Semite, that's a member of the Klan, that's a member of some publication that spews hate, division, anything like that. And I will never, I have, all you have to do is check the record to see how many times I have risked part of my career to stand up for the right thing to happen. And I will continue to do so, and that was the first subject I brought up here. The president has to stand firm for the decisions he makes. I'm voting for Americans, I'm voting for peace and security, I'm voting against any Nazi, any Klu Klan person, or anybody else. Period, end of sentence. And my last question, from the lady right here. Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
8 years for this?
Please be brave, Senator Isakson. Who will you answer our question? What's the age?
There's the one person of color gets to ask the question.
Who?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
Go ahead.
Okay.
I have heard the constituency in the state of Georgia and parts of Georgia that support Obamacare and everything that it entails referred to as a minority constituency, which may be factually true in this red state. However, that minority constituency, which is so vocal that I am a part of, we stand to incur fatalities for what we support being taken away from us. That is why, among other reasons, many other reasons, you're hearing such anger and fear and dissent in your audience, which I thank you for listening to. I encourage you to continue. But we have to know, we don't have a voice if you don't vote for us to keep health care that we have in place to keep us alive. It's a matter of life and death. That is why your vote and your voice for us needs, we need your support. We're desperate for your support. I need to know if you will support repealing nothing and fixing what we already have.
Thank you for your question, because you bring us back full cycle. You're not going to like part of this answer, but I got to repeat it, got to be consistent. To get to the point we could do exactly what you wanted, we had to move to a conference committee between the House and Senate. Just hold on a second. And I'm going to continue, regardless of obstacles, try and work with whoever will work with me to get us to a point that we have a health care law that works for all Americans across the country. And I'll continue to work for that as long as I'm in the United States Senate. So, let me thank everybody, regardless of their opinion of me, for coming tonight. I tell you what. Tell you what, you give me a chance to give you an answer, but you might be surprised at the answers you really get. The answer to your question is this.
I didn't get a question.
I appreciate all of you who came. I appreciate those of us who agree and disagree. Most importantly of all, I appreciate the United States of America, the greatest country on the face of this earth. You and I can make a difference, and I'll work with you to make that difference. The fact that we disagree does not mean we have to always disagree, and together we can come together and find solutions for all Americans. God bless all of you for being here tonight. God bless the United States of America.
My mother must be the one that got my wedding ring. Oh, God, he's working! I don't know.
feel lovely. He was here years ago.
$7.50.
That's old.
You can get a $7.50.
I know.